Okie Yeah, so this is where we left off before the break. So the structure factor has a as Fourier related to the pair correlation function. And again, just to graphically sum this up. So think about crystals. If there is some kind of ordering present in the sample, the crystal being the extreme case of that, then the structure factor will be less than one, and it will have influence on the scattering pattern. Actually, this is where the name structure factor comes from, of course, because if you now do a light scattering experiment, you measure the location of interference peaks, then you're basically probing the structure of a crystal. So that is where the that's where the name comes from. So the sample can be described. The sample itself can be described by its density, so rho, global density, or volume fraction, and this pair correlation function, radial distribution function is another name. And we made that, but I'm not going to repeat it because we already discussed this. Of course, we saw that different volume fractions give rise to different pair correlation functions. Now you've got going to put that into this Fourier integral. So so naturally the result of the integral will also depend on volume fraction because you put something different in, and then there's again an additional multiplication, additional scaling with density of or volume fraction as well in that that expression. So so you can basically expect that the you can expect that the structure factor will be dependent on the volume fraction. And what we'll see is if you have low densities, so or low volume fractions, then there will be weak ordering in the sample. So in general, if the density is low, then particles can just take random positions, apart from the fact that they cannot overlap, and that will mean that the structure factor will be close to one, close to unity. And if it was one, then basically that meant that there were no interference effects. So so that will happen for low density. For high density, then there will be stronger ordering, and then the structure factor will be different than one. So we could calculate the pair correlation function in the Perkachevich formalism. So that means that if we Fourier transform that, we can plot the structure factor, and that is what you see in this graph. So here is the on the horizontal, sorry, on the horizontal axis is the diameter of the particle times times the magnitude of the scattering factor Q, so 2 times k times the sine half theta for the same three volume fractions that that we saw earlier in the calculation of the pair correlation function. So here for the black one, the low volume fraction, you see that the structure factor as calculated is almost equal to unity. For the somewhat higher volume fraction of 20%, you see that that it drops for low values of Q, and then oscillates a little bit, but asymptotically goes to the value of one. And for the high volume fraction, that's it really starts to show distinct peaks, which of course scale again scale with the diameter. All right, so that's how it looks like. Of course, you remember that to include that the expression looked like the phase function, and then multiplied with the structure factor, and then integrate it from 0 to pi sine theta d theta.
Pardon the interruption. This looks very similar to the other graph with on the x-axis radius, but here d times q is something very different, right?
Yeah. Let me briefly. I'll put them together next to each other. Just one second. That's maybe that's a good idea. Quickly add slide. Okay, so yeah, so on the left, you see the pair correlation function g of r, and on the right you see the structure factor s of q. Basically, the pair correlation function is a function of distance, and the scattering factor is a function of q. But in this case, it's convenient to normalize them both on using the diameter of the particle. So if you do that on the left-hand side for the pair correlation function, then the scaling becomes r over d. So that's why it's zero up until one. And in the Fourier conjugate domain, that means that we have to multiply q with d. And in both cases, it also they become dimensionless. So r and d have the same dimension, so that the ratio becomes dimensionless. Q has the dimensions of k, which was 2 pi over lambda. So that has the dimensions of per meter, which means that the diameter times q also becomes dimensionless. So that is also out of convenience. Both can be peaked. So what you see is that for the low volume fractions, nothing really much happens. So in the pair correlation function on the left, you only see the restriction for distances less than the diameter, and after that, nothing much happens. For the structure factor, that basically means that over the whole range of q values, there is very little. You can see a very little dent here, but that's it. So it's almost equal to unity. And then for the very high volume fraction, for 50%, for example, then you see that there's a much increased probability of finding two particles next to each other. So there's a huge peak at a distance r that is equal to the diameter, or ratio of r over d is one. If you would consider two particles with exactly one particle in between, that would mean that the distance at center distance would be 2 times the diameter for that particle pair, so that also peaks, because in this high, if you really have this high volume fraction, then at a certain point all the particles will touch. So you will basically find some kind of repetition of locations that are multiples of the diameter. It's all considered from with respect to a reference particle, and all the other particles are placed around that in three dimensions. So for the larger distances. So not all the particles are stacked on a line. There is also, if you have one particle here, one here, and one here, then particle number three can be located a little bit in a dent, in a dent formed by the two particles, but it can also be exactly on top of one of the other particles. So the peaks do start to smear out. So if it's two particles, actually touching, then the distance is exactly one times the diameter. But if there is more or less one particle in between, there are a few more options to place the other particle. So these peaks do occur at multiples or around multiples of the diameter, but since you get more and more options to place the particles the farther away you go, these peaks do tend to vanish. That is on the side of the pair correlation function. Of course, if this is such a wild function, if you take the Fourier transform, that will also be a wild function. So that's what you see on the right-hand side for the structure factor. So you again see these peaks occurring, which basically correspond to the Fourier components of the oscillations here, which are more pronounced if the volume fraction is higher. So that means if the volume fraction is higher, you have less options to place your particles. You have a higher structuring, so that will give rise to more peaks. So if you would have a crystal, then the structure factor would basically be a series of very distinct peaks. And now, because it is particles that still even for very high volume fractions still have some freedom of placement, you still see these peaks, but they broaden a little bit. And if the argument gets higher, it oscillates down.
So here we have in one dimension, shouldn't it also work in a negative direction, since you can place particles in a 3D space?
Yeah, but it's the physical distance between the particles, so that is always a positive number.
Yeah.
It's not a coordinate, it's a distance.
So if I'm reading the graph on the right, in a right way, I can see based on the value of the structure factor where it's most likely that the particles are placed.
No, that is the one on the left. So the structure factor only only describes the interferences due to these particles. So if you would have the structure factor, you would want to tell something about the distances, then you would have to first Fourier transform it back.
Okay, then maybe someone else can explain, but I'm still not entirely sure how exactly to read the structure factor in that case. I might have to look back a bit on your previous explanation, but
let me scroll back a few slides. Maybe that. So if you look at this, the bottom equation here for the total scattering cross section, then you see that it has a part that says n times the scattering cross section of a single particle. So you have a collection of n particles, and you want to calculate the total scattering cross section. If there would be no relation between them whatsoever, so this condition of not being able to overlap is not there, then that would be just your end result. But now the fact that they can not overlap, they can touch, but they cannot overlap, that causes some kind of organization in the sample. So there will be some kind of phase relation between the scattered fields from the individual particles. Now that restriction of not being able to overlap, that is expressed in the pair correlation function. That is why you see in the graph of the pair correlation function that it starts out at zero and then jumps to some value and eventually becomes a one. So that part is by the pair correlation function. Pair correlation function is a measure of the likelihood of finding a certain distance between particle pairs. And then on the right-hand side is the effect of that organization. So if this organization gets there in the sample, then the phase differences between individual particles will not cancel anymore. So you have to take that into account, and that is done through the structure factor. So you can arrive at the structure factor from a whole different, and that's actually what we did a little bit. So we talked about organization and then had the pair correlation function. Then we jumped to the other side and said, okay, apparently we need to account for phase differences. And then we arrived at something that we call the structure factor. And that is then the part between the green accolade and in the function here. So you take in the expression here. So you take the phase function of single particle of one of the particles, because they are identical. You multiply that with the structure factor as of theta, and integrate that over the angular domain. So if S would be one, which is the case for low volume fractions, then you would just be integrating the phase function, and that term would evaluate to one. If it is less than if it is not one, let's put it that way, then this integral will evaluate to another number, which means that you add a correction term to the total scattering cross section.
Yeah, so would less than one kind of be like destructive interference and more than one?
Yeah, that's basically the result of destructive interference.
Okay. Yeah,
exactly.
Thank you.
Okay, while we're at it, take one close look, everybody, to this expression, because it has S of theta times the phase function, and then integrate it from zero to pi sine theta d theta. Now, if we go back to where we were, let's take this one here. So here on the horizontal axis for the structure factor, we have Q. Q was defined as 2 times k times sine theta d theta. Theta, on the other hand, we know only runs from 0 to pi. So the sine of half pi is, what is it, 1? So that means that even though this axis of d times q runs on forever, the only part that you can actually use in the calculation like this is the part that runs from d times 2 times k, and then sine theta d theta is half sine, and then sine half theta is equal to 1. So even though we can calculate it on an axis of q that seems to run on forever, q is in practice, if you want to use it in a calculation, then q is limited to some point on this axis. So that means, for example, that let's take a hypothetical situation where that limit would correspond to a 5, let's say a value of 5 here on the horizontal axis. So if you would if you would convert this axis to a theta axis for a given particle size and a given wavelength, let's say that it would only run to 5. That means that that what you have to include in that integral of the phase function could be, for example, for the blue curve, could be only this very short and very low amplitude piece of the curve. So if you would multiply the phase function with this low a value and then perform the integration, then you'll see that that the correction factor, so to say, is going to be a very, very small number, which means that there is a lot of destructive interference, and the scattering, total scattering cross section will be greatly reduced due to these effects. Let's look at the practical example for this. So this is again the expression for the scattering coefficient. Now, for the scattering coefficient expressed as a product of the scattering coefficient for the independent case, so where we do not take into account interferences, and then multiplied with this structure factor based correction. So in the integral, we have the phase function of the single particle, and we have the theta and volume fraction dependent structure factor. So now we can calculate this using the independent scattering coefficient using Mie theory. That is simply calculating the scattering cross section using Mie theory, and then multiplying with the density. That would give us the blue part. And for the red part, to calculate the red part, we can use we can use Perkasiewicz to calculate the structure factor, and still use Mie theory to calculate the phase function of a single particle. So we can make two calculations. You will see in the next slide. So one is in blue. That is the independent part where we ignore all the phase differences, so no interferences. And the red part is the whole story. So where the phase differences are included. So that is one calculation for the scattering coefficient that I'll show. And the other one this may look a little bit complicated, but we can also calculate an average phase function for this ensemble. So if we take the angular parts together, so the phase function of a single particle, and multiply that with the structure factor, that would be kind of an effective angular redistribution of the scattered light. So the structure factor just suppresses certain angles. And of course, a phase function by definition is normalized. So that explains why there is also a denominator in this expression to make sure that this phase function is normalized again. So I'm going to calculate that as well. So the phase function of a single particle will be in blue. And then the effective phase function of a collection of particles will be in red. And what we'll see is that for low volume fraction, the structure factor goes to unity, and then the scattering coefficient and the phase function in the red calculations are going to overlap or going to approximate the ones in blue. Okay, so this is part of the simulation. So it is a Mie calculation of a sphere of 500 nanometer radius. I forgot to put on which wavelength it was. I think it is 632 as it was before. So let's assume that for now. And then using Mie theory and this Perkasiewicz approximation, I've calculated the scattering coefficient on the right-hand side. and the phase function on a polar plot on the left-hand side. So let's first look at the scattering coefficient graph. This particular calculation is for a volume fraction of 5%, 0.05. And in the next few slides, I will be increasing the volume fraction. So blue is the blue dot here is the blue point in the graph is the calculation without taking into account interferences. So that would lead to let's say a scattering coefficient of 30 per millimeter on this axis. And if we take into account the structure factor already at this low volume fraction, you can see a strong result. So it is already the destructive interference that occurs due to the ordering of these spheres already suppresses the absorption the scattering coefficient in this experiment to about 10 per millimeter. So let's say about a factor 3 already. If you now look at the left graph, that is a polar plot. So light is coming in from the left here along K in. So that means that along this axis is a zero scattering angle. And then if you walk along the polar plot, and then that is increasing scattering angle. So what this basically shows is that most of the light is all light is scattered in the forward hemisphere, and actually a lot of it is scattered in the forward direction. So this would be a phase function that corresponds to a relatively high value of the scattering anisotropy G. In blue, you see they more or less overlaps still here. In blue, you see the curve for the independent scattering, so ignoring phase differences, and in red when they are included. Okay, so now let's increase the volume fraction. So that means that there will be a different structure factor that we need to take into account because that dependent on that was dependent on the volume fraction. So this is doubling the volume fraction now to 10%, and you see that again, first looking at the scattering coefficient in the independent case, that would just lead a doubling of the volume fraction, a doubling of the density, that would just lead to a doubling of the scattering coefficient. So what we'll see as we move through the slides is that the blue line in this graph will simply increase linearly with volume fraction. For the red curve, we now had to use a different structure factor because we had a different volume fraction. And the result of this is even more suppression of more destructive interferences. So even a lower, still a little bit of an increase of the scattering coefficient compared to the previous value. So, but not a doubling. So the scaling is not linear. It's much lower than what you would get in the independent case, and it is also less than twice what we had for the previous volume fraction. So we'll see that as we move on, we'll see that effect gets stronger. But also, if you take a look now at the phase function for a single particle, not taking into account interferences, nothing will change. So also going forward to the next slides, the blue curve will just remain what it is. But in red, we now see the effective phase function. So what you get due to the structure factor is that some scattering angles are attenuated a little bit more than other scattering angles. So you get a little bit of a redistribution of the scattered light, and that is seen here in this red curve going. So there is a little bit less light scattered in the forward direction, and it has to go somewhere. So that means that it goes more to the side scatter directions. Which means that the average cosine of the scattering angle, the anisotropy factor, will be a little bit less compared to what we had in the previous volume fraction. Okay, now so let's increase it again now to 15%. And you see the effect gets it's the same. So the blue curve for the scattering coefficient simply scales linearly. The red curve for the dependent case, the scattering coefficient will increase because we add more particles, but again the increase will not be proportional. It will be a different function of the volume fraction in red there, and the effect for the phase function is also gets stronger as we increase the volume fraction. So blue, where we ignore it, nothing happens. And red, where we take it into account, is again less light scattered in the forward direction and more light scattered sideways. So a flatter appearance of the phase function, which would correspond to an even smaller anisotropy value. This is for 25%, for 20%. This is for 25%, and finally for 30%. So, with the risk of annoying you with repeating the argument, blue line, just a linear increase with volume fraction. So doubling the volume fraction will lead to a doubling of the scattering coefficient. Due to interferences, due to the fact that we have to that we get a different structure factor at every volume fraction, we see we do see an increase with of scattering coefficient with volume fraction, but it is not a linear increase. It is a it's some kind of nonlinear increase, and the net effect of that is that the actual scattering coefficient of such an collection of particles is going to be much less than the scattering coefficient of if these particles would not interact at all. So that is one effect. The other effect is on the distribution of light, the angular redistribution of light. So if you have a relatively large particle, as in this simulation, then most of the light for a single particle would be scattered in the forward direction. That is the blue curve. But now this ensemble at high concentration makes sure that that light is scattered more sideways and less in the forward direction. So that would be a scattering anisotropy that is much less in this case than for the independent case. So these are the effects that that occur. Okay, is this measured? Yes, of course this is measured. This is just one example from the literature. This is a measurement where on the horizontal axis you have volume fraction. Somehow the label got lost, and on the right hand side on vertical axis is a measurement of the scattering coefficient. Here you see the measurement and an empirical fit of the scattering coefficient as a function of a volume fraction, for which they use symbol rho here a little bit confusingly. You can see that it is nonlinear, in this case actually quadratic, dependent on the volume fraction. In blue, that is my sketch, is the line that you would find if there would be no scattering at all. So it is an effect that actually occurs. To close for today, I would like to run through an example with you that uses this formalism, namely to calculate the scattering properties of blood. So blood is a very dense solution. The volume fraction, or for blood as it's called the hematocrit, is 45%. So almost half of it is, on average, so most half of it is taken up by red blood cells. So the goal of the calculation now is to calculate the scattering coefficient of blood. In order to do that, we'll try to calculate the total scattering cross section using the methods that we discussed, and then divide by the volume to get the scattering coefficient. To do this calculation, we'll use Mie theory. So we'll approximate the red blood cell as a sphere. We'll use Mie theory to calculate the scattering cross section and the phase function of an individual red blood cell. And we'll use this Perkasievic. Since we're approximating the particle as a sphere anyway, we can use Perkasievic to estimate the structure factor. And in this case, in this formula, the structure factor is again written in its original definition as the average of all these phase differences. So basically, again, just like in the previous example, we can build that expression for independently scattering particles, so not taking into account phase functions, and that means that the part of the expression after the multiplication sign is trivial, that should evaluate to one. And in the case of dependent scattering, where we do take it into account, we include the structure factor in that integral part. All right. To come a little bit full circle, in order to calculate the scattering properties using meat theory, we need to know the size and the refractive index. Well, the average volume of a red blood cell is 90 cubic micron, I think. So if you would calculate an equivalent spherical radius, that would be around 3 micron. So that can be put in. We need the refractive index of the red blood cell. And for that, we can use this causality and Kramers-Kronig that we discussed a little while ago. So we can measure the absorption coefficient of hemoglobin and then use the Kramers-Kronig analysis to translate that into the refractive index of hemoglobin. So what is in the red blood cell? So if we have this spectrum, or this spectrum of the somewhat larger wavelength range, we can use meat theory to calculate the scattering coefficient at each wavelength, so we can build a spectrum of the scattering coefficient as a function of wavelength. This is again the input, but we discussed this graph, so I'm going to skip over this now. This is a calculation. Basically, the result of that calculation, if we calculate the scattering coefficient using meat theory and using Perkis-Jevic for blood at a volume fraction of 45%, at an hematocrit of 45%. So we calculated the corresponding structure factor for 45% volume fraction and used that in the calculation. And then with the refractive index spectra as an input, these are the results of the calculation. So on the horizontal axis, you have wavelength, and on the vertical axis, we have the scattering coefficient. For oxygenated hemoglobin, that is the red curve, and for deoxygenated hemoglobin, that is the blue curve. So this is the result of the calculation. Maybe I do have to go back to the previous slide. So this was the input. The refractive index input was calculated from the Kramers-Kronig relations, but when we discussed this, I also showed you this measurement, for which I was partly satisfied. I was satisfied that our calculations had the same showed more or less the same features as this measurement, but we also saw that the magnitude is a little bit different, which could be due to experimental errors on either their side or our side. That I do not know, but the value was a little bit different. So we were interested in how the calculated scattering coefficient would look like if we used that refractive index as an input. And that is then the gray dotted line that you also see in this graph. So the basically result of that is that you get higher values for the scattering coefficient. So that's the spectrum for the scattering coefficient. On the right, the graph on the right shows the scattering anisotropy, so the average cosine of the scattering angle as a function of wavelength. And we can see that it is high. So the x's ranges from 0.9 to 1. It is high, which is what we expect for large particles compared to the wavelength. So again, the radius of this particle is in the order of 3.5 micron. So that is much larger than the wavelength. It's a really large scatterer. And what's also interesting is that both in the spectrum for the scattering coefficient and also a little bit in the spectrum for the anisotropy, you see these oscillations here, or these anomalies. And they occur as we expected, just at the same wavelengths where the absorption is really high. So what we already knew from the Kramers-Kronig relations is that if you have a high absorption peak, you will get a strong oscillation in the refractive index spectrum over there. Well, if you then put that into a scattering theory, you can expect that this strong oscillation in the refractive index will also lead to a strong fluctuation is a better word, a strong fluctuation in the scattering coefficient. So that is what you see here. The second rule of thumb that we knew from the Kramers-Kronig relation is that if there was a huge absorption peak at some lower wavelength, then the real part of the refractive index at wavelengths much larger than that would be a decreasing function of wavelength. Well, if you put a decreasing function of wavelength into a scattering theory, then you would get a scattering coefficient that is also a decreasing function of wavelength, and that is what you see happening here. So let's say for the larger wavelengths, much larger than the absorption peak at 500 nanometer, you see that it decreases with wavelength. So the next step, what we try to do is compare this to literature values. In literature values, the problem that you encounter is that these measurements are not standardized. And a lot of people, of course, immediately realize that if you want to measure at whole blood, you have a whole lot of very much absorption, strong scattering, and a very difficult sample to handle. So what most people do is dilute the blood to a volume fraction that is experimentally manageable, and then report that result. And if you're out of luck, they will just scale it linearly back to 45% to be able to report scattering of blood itself. Now, of course, we know now that you cannot do that linear scaling because for every volume fraction, you have a different structure factor that is going to affect your results. So what we did is took all these measurements from literature, and yes, you can see in the legend there is a big variation in the volume fractions at which they measured. We calculated the structure factor for that volume fraction, calculated back what the phase function and the scattering coefficient would be in the independent case. Then we calculated the structure factor for the 45% that we want to use, and then scaled using that scaled up to 45%. So what you see here is on the top graph, you see the unscaled spectra from literature. So there's a group of there in the top that is measured at approximately the same volume fraction. So these curves approximately overlap, and there is a bunch of there below here that are measured at much lower coefficient. Okay, so then we applied that rescaling, and as you can see, you get some interesting results. So the ones that were already close together get a little bit closer together. So that is good news. The green one, for example, here that was measured at a hematocrit of about 9%, volume fraction of 9%. If you using these calculations scale that up to about 45%, there is a nice overlap between the at the lower wavelengths, not so nice at the higher wavelengths. Not sure why that is. For the blue curve over there, the effect is more or less the same. So you have a nice somewhat nice overlap at the lower wavelengths, a little bit less at the higher wavelengths, and there is one spectrum that really scales bizarrely. That is the gray dotted line there. So what you can do then is take all these rescaled spectra from the literature and calculate an average spectrum from that, so let's call that the average literature spectrum, and then compare that to our calculations that we did in the previous slide, so the pure calculations, and that is what you see on the right bottom right graph. So the black curve is the average from literature, and the red and the blue are purely calculations, so purely based on Kramers-Kronig and me and Perkosiewicz structure factor. So essentially, we were actually kind of satisfied with this result because for the whole wavelength range, what we calculate is in the right order of magnitude compared to what is found in the literature. The features in the spectrum, so the anomalies, the fluctuations occur at the same wavelength. So we predict we accurately predict what wavelength dependence is. So that means that we can that we're also quite confident that we can use these calculations, for example, as an input for Monte Carlo simulations, where we would need to know optical properties. So we don't have to do measurements all the time. We can just calculate it. So that is a straightforward application of what we discussed today. That's also the last thing that I wanted to mention to you. So that means that I'm not going to run through these questions, but these are the typical things that we discussed today. So dependent scattering relating to the phase relations between the scattered fields of different particles, and as a result of that, the optical properties like scattering coefficient and anisotropy factor will not scale linearly with volume fraction anymore. Are there any questions about this part? I mean, about this. Okay, if not, then I have one last announcement, and that is about the assignments. So because of the whole rearrangement of the schedule this week, I also got a little bit into trouble with my assignments. So I want to give you an assignment today. I already put it on Canvas. As you remember, the grading is three assignments of 25 points each, and then an oral exam also for 25 points. So that you can get 100 points. That will, of course, determine your grade. The oral exam is must pass, so you have to have a passing grade for that oral exam. And the other ones count as they come in. You're allowed to make these assignments alone or in a group. Please limit the group size to three people. You can do it by yourself with two people or three people. That's up to you. But I would like for the next assignment, you will have to be in another group. So I don't want to have three assignments that are made by the same group. The assignment is on Canvas, so you can look at that already. It is a new assignment, so it has not been battle tested yet. So if you find anything that is not clear, please contact me, and then I can try to make it clearer and post revision. Sorry.
I have a question because I'm on the Canvas page right now, and I do see module assignment one. Only I do not see anything in the module.
I'm sorry, my bad. Click. Okay, can you try now? It's on top. Yeah.
I can see that.
Yeah. Okay. Great.
Yeah. Same here.
Okay. Super. Let's say that we take a week for you to complete this assignment. So our regular class is on Friday. So that means that I would like to have this assignment back before next Friday's. So not tomorrow, but the week after that Friday class. And I would appreciate if you could, if you do form a group, I would appreciate that you already send me with whom you're doing it. Then I can make a nice Excel sheet from that already. Yeah. Okay, that's it. Tomorrow is Johannes on OCT. So if you want to prepare for that a little bit, then you could go through his slides again. But other than that, I'm not exactly sure what he's going to talk about. So I guess that we'll have to wait and see. All right. Have a nice day.
Okay, you too.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.